Hi, everyone. I'm Maria Bailey, and I'm going to be moderating this panel. The way we're going to work the panel is each of our panelists will introduce themselves with a short slide. I'll open and start the questions, and then we'll open the floor to the audience, and you can ask questions as well. Just to make it a little bit more exciting, not every panelist will answer every question. So if you would like to direct your question to someone specific, that's good. So we'll just get started. My name is Maria Bailey. I'm the CEO of BSM Media. That's me. I've written 8 books on marketing to moms and millennials. It's what I've been doing for the last 20 years. And I do a lot of research. I execute marketing programs on behalf of a lot of companies. And I'm delighted to be here again. Thanks to Robin and Tonda for inviting me. So Devorah Tim, we'll start with you.
I didn't know we had a slide, so this is great.
Yeah.
So hi, everyone. My name is Tim Bucher, and I head up the consumer business at Seagate, which is all of our Seagate-branded products that you find in retail, as well as our LaCie products, which are really focused on the creative professional all the way to the Hollywood studios. And so that's a little bit about what I do. Should I talk about the life hack device?
Sure, yes.
Families, one of the things that I'm very, very focused on and have been for my entire career is really about helping families, moms, dads, consumers in general with their data, right? If you think about families, one of the most important assets they have, if you want to call it an asset, are their life memories and their tax files and whatever other content that they have. But families aren't necessarily IT professionals, and they really don't want to be, but they want that data to last forever. And you've all heard of the cloud, and there are many clouds, and the biggest cloud in the world is Amazon. And so what I said was, hey, why don't we take one of our drives, our USB drive, that consumers and families are really used to dragging and dropping and copying content onto, and create an automatic way for that content to then also get reflected into the cloud. So now, instead of the cloud being this nebulous thing, it's actually a physical device with an Amazon brand on it and a Seagate brand on it, two trusted brands. This is a product that just started shipping a month ago, and it's been a great success for both Amazon and Seagate. From an Amazon perspective, it's about merchandising a nebulous thing as a physical thing. And for the families, it's about being able to just drag and drop, not changing any paradigm, and not only getting that extra level of protection, they get the high performance locally, and most importantly then is they use the Amazon mobile apps and they can see, whether it's Prime Photos or Amazon Drive mobile app, all of their content from anywhere. So that's a recent life hack that we've done at Seagate.
Great, great. Thank you. Our next speaker.
Yeah, that's me. Bryson Gardner. I'm one of the co-founders and CEO at Pearl. And David Pogue was talking earlier about all this great advancement in automotive and that you see here at CES, from self-driving cars to Alexa in the car and all the partnerships. And one thing that that's in common with all of these people is that they all want you to buy a new car. We don't think that that's right. We don't think you should have to buy a new car to get the latest features. And here in the U.S., there's about 10 million car crashes per year. And it's the number one leading cause of death for teenagers as well. And so we are initially and solely focused on aftermarket road safety and fixing that problem. Our first product is a self-install backup camera. It's a rear vision system that provides obstacle alerts. And then we're going to have a series of products coming out over the next 2 years that complement the safety suite around the vehicle.
Great. Thank you. Darren? Hi, Darren.
Hi. I'm Darren Guccione. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Keeper Security. We make the world's leading password manager and secure digital vault for smartphones, tablets, and computers. So think of a ubiquitous digital vault for all of the passwords and private files, photos, documents that you'd like completely encrypted and secure that syncs with all of your devices. We've got millions of customers, both businesses and consumers. And our main purpose when it comes to families is really protecting your digital assets. So all of that secret information, whether it's a trust, an estate, family photos, sensitive information like tax returns, financial statements, as well as all of the passwords for all of your websites. So with our product, you never have to remember a password ever again. You can use your fingerprint to log into your vault from any device, as long as your device supports biometrics. And then it's very simple. It logs you into all of your sites. So you mentioned Amazon. We're a big Amazon partner as well. And we work with all of them big OEMs and mobile device operators like AT&T and other companies in Europe and the Far East as well. So nice to see everybody today.
Great. And let me guess, Devorah, you're the next speaker.
So I'm Devorah Heitner, and I founded Raising Digital Natives to help adults understand and support and mentor kids around technology and to be less panicked around the ways that kids use technology. There's a lot of panic among teachers and parents still. It may be hard to believe here at CES because there's mostly enthusiasm here, but there's still quite a lot of panic. And so my hack is, well, and I should say I'm the author of Screenwise, and which is about a tech-positive approach to guiding kids and raising kids in the digital age. And I have a TEDx as well on YouTube called Empathy is the App. So that's a core philosophy that I have, that really we want to be understanding the ways people use technology as opposed to panicking, shutting them down, et cetera. And mentoring kids is more powerful than monitoring in the digital world. So that's my hack, right? This is a concept that is really important to remember when we think about the ways adults are guiding kids with technology. There's a lot of apps, as you all know, maybe some of you work on these apps that monitor kids. And monitoring may have its place, and it's good for kids to also be savvy about when they are being monitored. If they're using Google Apps at school and school knows everything, then it's good for kids to know, right? We should disclose to kids what we do and don't know and the monitoring that they experience. They need to be really savvy about privacy. This is a generation that really does need to grow up with that understanding. But we shouldn't monitor in place of mentoring. Kids should also be thinking about their digital reputation. They should be thinking about the ways they use the cloud, the ways that they share their own work, the ways that they're creating portfolios in and out of school, and they should be really mentored by us. We need to be able to talk to kids about the ways they're using technology and give them positive feedback, share with them when things maybe aren't such a good idea, help them troubleshoot and problem solve. A lot of digital citizenship folks get very focused on prevention. You know, how can we keep kids from making mistakes? But kids will inevitably, like all of us, make mistakes. So how can we mentor them and help them learn to repair and move forward when they make mistakes?
Great, good feedback. I'm gonna be using the term millennial moms a lot, probably, and millennial families. I like to, a lot of times we use that terminology and you hear it in the media, especially like during the elections, you know, the millennial voter. But in reality, the millennial generation is almost 20 years. And the older millennials act very differently than younger millennials, i.e. Pinterest versus Snapchat, right? So I'm gonna try to clarify if I'm talking about the younger millennial mom or the older one when I ask your question, so that we can just put it into perspective, because I think sometimes when you generalize, you lose sight of the real opportunities based on the consumer behavior. So Bryson, I want to ask you first a question about the technologies that you're focusing on in the car. So the younger millennial families tend to purchase fewer new cars than any other generation. This is kind of like a new phenomenon. How do you identify what technologies are important to focus on? I mean, you just talked about the rear. So how do you, there's so many that to bring a car up to date with safety features, how do you identify? And if you could be a little tactical in that, because I know we have a lot of developers in the audience who are trying to also identify those opportunity and solution points for their products.
Yeah, and actually the average age of the new car buyer is 52 in the US, so not very many young people buy new cars at all. And it's mostly in the used car market, but the features that come out in automotive, as they become more prevalent in the marketplace, then the awareness grows. And then for us, it's really starting with a backup camera. There's about 20 to 25% of the cars on the road today in the US have a backup camera. So the awareness is at a point where people know the feature and get accustomed to the feature, but yet there's still 200 million cars on the road without it. Mm-hmm. So as we look at additional features on our roadmap, they're really features that people are becoming accustomed to and want in the other vehicle in their driveway. And that's typically the model. The additional focus on the millennial side is that there is, especially with young millennials, there's an expectation about communication in terms of messaging versus voice.
Right.
And when you combine that messaging with the vehicle, then there's there are really bad consequences. There's unprecedented rise in fatalities over the last 2 years.
Right.
So that's a particular product that needs to be focused towards that generation.
Okay. Darren, today's mom is like it used to be when I wrote my very first book, moms said that they were the chief executive officer of their homes. Today, the millennial moms, when I ask that same question, call themselves the chief operating officer. So they're very functional in the way that they look at their role in the household. And that's probably been the biggest, out of all the research I've done, has been the biggest difference. Moms are not only managing their own passwords. I mean, I'm going through the college application process right now with my daughter, and we share an account. Have you identified ways that your service can help her in those multiple roles that she's trying to
Yeah, that's a good question. So, passwords are always the toughest thing because, for example, we have three small kids, 8, 11, and 13. They have a plethora of devices, right? They have tablets, smartphones, computers, all of them do. And they have sites they have to log into. Even my 8-year-old has websites that he uses. So we have a family plan. And the family plan makes my wife the administrator of the plan, and she can see all of our kids, in this little control panel and all the devices that they use. And she can basically set up, different types of provisions and controls on what they can and cannot do within the application. So the key is that, with the proliferation of devices, especially connected objects, it's becoming increasingly difficult to manage these things and have everything secure. And at the same time, knowing what your kids are doing, that's the key, is that you have to have visibility over their online hygiene and password hygiene. That's critical. And that's, it allows her to be, from a healthy perspective, nosy.
Right. So. It's an interesting factoid that came out in some recent research that we did. The average millennial mom has 23 apps on her wireless device, and only on average 3 of them were her selection.
Yeah.
And the rest came from family members wanting those apps to go on her wireless device, which is kind of interesting, And speaking of wireless devices, Tim, you and I were talking about photos earlier. And photos probably are one of the biggest behaviors when it comes to wireless devices, because moms are the chief archive officer of their home as well, and it chronicles their journey through motherhood. They get to brag with them, they get to share them. Can you talk about a little bit about how you're looking at that? Because there's a ton, even if you aren't in the photo business, for anybody who is developing any kind of technology, photo is such an important part of it. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, life memories, as I call them, right? It's photos and it's videos, and not everything gets posted to social networks, but that is another vehicle that families are using to help with that archival process, especially the millennial moms, young and old millennials. It's funny to say old millennials.
Yeah, I know.
that must make me a really old dad. But, with the products that we create, we want to make sure, our mission as a company is to help protect everyone's digital digital assets, forever, right? If you think about it, when you take that picture in the old days when it was a printout and that, photo paper or that negative would decay over time, But digitally, there should be no reason for it to decay over time. So whether it's products that just locally, you copy your stuff over to it, I really think, though, the millennials need that IT professional that I was talking about earlier. And those IT professionals, I think, range from social networks to services that are dedicated to, you know, photos or videos, or just everything in general, like, say, an Amazon Drive account. When we look at, and this is, you know, sort of confidential information, but we ship 22 million consumer devices that go to real consumers and real millennials and old dads like me. And we don't know the content on it, but we know the type of content on it. And we ship on average for a single device 2 terabytes now, right? Wow. In the old days, it was, you know, my goodness, I have 300 right. gigabytes and it's huge. Now the average product that we sell is 2 terabytes, and of that, more than 70% is photos and videos. Mm-hmm. And then when you talk to, say, Google, and, you know, they have data centers that have 16 million 10 terabyte hard drives in them, and you say, well, what are people storing on there? And they go, it's photos and videos. Mm-hmm. And it's not just YouTube.
Right.
So I think it's important that the millennial family finds services from trusted sources, devices and services from trusted sources that can help them protect that forever. And that's why I really think a trusted cloud service, a lot of people are afraid of cloud, and Devorah, you mentioned that, right?
Yeah.
It's so true, and it's very cultural too. Like, you know, in Germany, we sell a lot of hard drives, a lot of local storage. And it's because they're much more afraid of the cloud than they are here. But if you have clouds, you know, like, you know, the big four, who actually help protect content for banks and the CIA and governments and whatnot, you know, that should be good enough. And with, you know, services like yours, right, to help on the front end,
yeah.
That really should be something that I hope over time millennial families and old families embrace more and more.
Well, I want to get to some of the challenges, but I want to ask a question of the three of you real quickly. Because a lot of people in this room are developing, they've identified, okay, we've got a solution for a family, and it's a really good solution. But families are being inundated with a lot of really great solution, probably, you know, 8 football fields worth, you know, we'll be talking to them at some point. How have you found any particularly good tactic or way to communicate your benefit to the family that has just been overly successful for you that you wouldn't mind sharing?
Let's just start.
Yeah, so I mean, from our side, we just released our product a few months ago. So mm-hmm. for us, it's really the test and scale model. So through each of the different social channels, we have different formats, and then we track performance, and then track performance with different messaging on our website, track performance with different advertisements, and then we iterate that on an ongoing basis. So we're still, from our side, we're still figuring out the best way to kind of rise above the noise.
Right. So. Right.
The key, there's two things. Number one is access. So allow a family to access our system from the devices that they already own. Mm-hmm. Don't have them buy new hardware. Don't worry about firewalls or anything like that. Have everything built into the user interface and the overall architecture of the product, and then it makes it really easy. Number two, keep it super simple and really easy to use. I know, like, you hear that all the time, but the hardest thing in what we do as software developers is refining. We spend so much time iterating and just refining the daylights out of the product so that it's super simple to use. The learning curve should be, you know, it shouldn't require a training manual or any type of, you know, detailed, you know, study guide to get going on it. You should be up and running within a minute. So that's what we've worked really hard at trying to create. And when you do that and you service the product well, it just creates this virality. And that's what we've been able to benefit, you know, for the last 4 years on.
Yeah, I find that one of the challenges that most app developers in particular tell me about is, like, you know, just getting moms and dads to find them is the most difficult part of the whole process, because there's so many out there. Yeah. Tim, have you figured out a way to
I was about to add to this conversation. We have a little bit of a different situation, and I actually think it's, it's quite a blessing. It's called retail. And about a year and a half ago, we took over the category management, the product management of how it's presented in retail with our retail partners. And it's also, when you look at, you know, Amazon.com or other e-tailers, the content that you put on there. So when you have, you know, tens of thousands of retail outlets and you are, you know, shipping millions of products online, the messaging about solutions or applications in that category management gives us an unfair advantage, or it's just, you know, it took a long time to get there.
Right.
And to your point, you know, there are football fields of companies. How do they get to that point?
Right.
One of the things that I'm finding is I'm partnering with those football fields of companies, mm-hmm. where it makes sense for solutions that storage can enable for data. And so you're seeing a lot more of that coming over time. And it's everything from, you know, the photo and video editing software that you then have preloaded, to even, you know, hardware devices like drones. We just announced a partnership with DJI. So it's a tough one. It's a really tough one. Being an entrepreneur, I was acquired by Seagate about 15 months ago, and that's how I got in. And in all my startups, that's the number one issue, is awareness.
I think that you've hit on something. I think that the partnerships are a good way to get your product out there, because then what it does, to Darren's point, is it makes it easy, because the parent finds it unexpectedly. They find you and they're like, wow, they were there when I needed them at the right time. Yeah. And that's where the loyalty starts to develop between the startup and the family.
Yep, agreed. It brings you to demographics that you may not have been exposed
to. Yeah.
And that's something that as startups, you don't always think about partnerships, mm-hmm. right? I mean, it takes a lot of time, and sometimes big companies are, you know, don't want to deal with startups, but you know, at Seagate, we embrace innovation, and I think big companies are embracing it more and more and more, and that's how I encourage the awareness to happen.
Well, speaking of startups, a lot of startups happen in the world of apps. Everybody launches an app, and the 65% of toddlers by the age of 2 have been on some kind of wireless device, according to our research. And I was just wondering, Devorah, what new challenges does that present to the millennial parent who, you know, in the past, you could just, that problem will happen later, it will happen later. Well, now and it's not so much a problem, but the opportunity now has come to, you know, where a child will have something connected the minute they're born sometimes.
Sure.
So what challenges has that presented, and what opportunities does that open up for people who are out there developing products?
I think parents are excited to share the world of wireless and apps with their kids. That's why they're handing over their smartphones. And they're impressed with the ways that kids are really very facile with tablets and smartphones, because they're very intuitive. You don't have to be a reader. You can look up a solution on YouTube. Mm-hmm. You know, and as a 3 or 4 year old. So I think parents are in some sense excited, but they're also bombarded with these messages of guilt and being told, you know, that you're a bad parent if your kid is using technology. And so then what is the qualitative standard they're supposed to use? If on one hand I'm a bad mommy because my kid has seen tech, and on the other hand I'm, you know, my kid is going to be this incredible inventor because he has this awesome facility with maybe inventing things on the iPad, how do I reconcile that and, you know, forge my own path? And I think a lot of parents, to come back to this question of how are parents being introduced to apps, a lot of it is through their kids, maybe not some, you know, cloud storage, for example, through their kids. But you do have a lot of families where it's the kid who's the IT director or the kid who's the problem solver on tech. And then you have the kid's priorities are going to rule that. And the kid's priorities may not be secure passwords. The kid's priority may be optimizing battery life and time on game and getting to the next level. And so if that's the case, then and that's a perfectly valid priority for that person. But they're not thinking about should these photos be archived. In fact, if you could make more space on the family machine. I mean, I've talked to families where the kids erased troves of family archive to create more space, and families didn't know till much later because the family curatorial role isn't like an everyday role. It's like a once a year when I go to make that calendar for grandpa, you know, then I'm going to look at the photos and oops, where'd they go? Right. Too late now, right, in some cases. So I think that kids are serving these roles as, you know, sometimes even tech mentors to their parents. And honestly, though, there are a lot of toddler apps that are junk, and I think we've all seen toddler apps that are junk. So the high quality stuff in the early childhood space, I think, is there's not so much of it. And so for how are parents supposed to go into the app store? I have colleagues who call the education section of the app store the Wild West. You know, you go in there, and there's tons of junk, and there's some gems, too. But how do you find the gems?
Right.
So. It's tricky. Not every parent's going to, you know, follow an awesome blogger that's going to lay out for them and review things for them. They're not going to go to Toy Expo and find the coolest thing. And so they might just find whatever junk, and then it's not that interesting.
You reminded me of a commercial that I saw last week in London on the television. It was for Virgin Media, so you can go to Google and just watch it. But it was so on target. All it was kids, and they were saying, I fixed the network in our house. And the next one was like, you know, I synced up all of my parents', you know, passwords in the cloud. And it was all children saying this. And then the very last one, you know, was a call out to Virgin Media. But it was so on target that, and the point was, it's as easy as, you know, even adult can do it, basically, was the message. So that's it good. Was really good.
That's what I tell schools to do with their little hackers, is, you know, enroll and have them be the geek squad, because that's what you want, is to you know, use their power.
So I'm going to ask one more question, and then I'm going to open it up to the audience. But I like to get to the really meaty questions sometimes, the money questions, okay? So pricing. Pricing is really important when it comes to getting a buy-in from the family, right? I mean, I have a millennial and he just bought a house and he's not going to get cable, he's not going to get a phone, you know, like if it's not a benefit to him. How do you find that right price point, and how do you communicate that it's a good enough value that these frugalistas, which are now like it's in vogue to be a frugalista, right, for a millennial, how do you get that frugalista millennial to see the value in what you're providing? Anyone can answer that question.
Sure, I'll start. From our side, automotive is actually transportation is the number two household expenditure behind housing. And is ahead of things like food. So it's a very large expense that you have to begin with. And you know, our mission is making the most of the car that you already have. And the average new car loan payment is over $500 a month. So from our perspective, we're looking to augment the car. And you know, rather than feeling pressure to go buy a new car, that you're able to make yours last as long as possible.
Do you communicate that prior to the car? So. The car buying process can start 18 months before they actually purchase the car, maybe 6 months, let's say. So are you communicating that benefit to them prior to the car purchase by segmenting, you know, potential car buyers, or are you communicating that after the sale?
Yeah, those are things. I mean, that's everything that we're working on now, best understand the market. And in general, I mean, the car buying experience is terrible. Everybody knows it, right?
That's been documented.
Yeah, so something on our side is that we give people the ability not to have to go through the car buying process. So that's certainly a primary audience for us. But we increasingly over time looking to see our products as an option to those built into cars, the same way the GPS is now. You don't go buy a new or used car and say, I really want GPS, you just use your phone. Right. So we're doing the same thing for all the safety systems in the cars.
You know, Maria, we find, of course, that, you know, there are the frugalistas that look for the absolute lowest cost. And, you know, in the consumer world, when you get under $100, you know, your volume can kick up. And we certainly see that in our volume. But recently, we've started to create products that are more focused around experiences. And what we're finding is that consumers will actually pay more for that. I'll give you a very simple example. And Devorah, you talked about gaming, right? So we created a product for the gamers out there, because they fill up their consoles very quickly. I have like, you know, 50 products in my coat pocket here. So we created a game drive. Sounds very simple. You know, we have the Xbox logo and the Seagate logo. And this is sold not in storage aisle, but it's sold in the gaming aisle as part of a gaming experience. And guess what? We charge $10 more for this than for its equivalent 4 terabyte or 2 terabyte, whatever the capacity point is. Because it's not about capacity point, it's not about lowest cost, it's can you give me a complete drone experience, right? And all the bundles that I need. And you know, with the data explosion that is going on, that's really the strategy that I'm focused on is it's actually raising prices. Mm-hmm. And frugalistas are looking for, yes, a value, but they want it to just work. They want it to be, you know, seamless, especially for families. And so we're seeing both, right? We're seeing the $59 to the, you know, $129 or whatever it might be.
But you just tapped into, like, you're right on with the whole experience. I mean, that's what millennials are all about. That's why they've created all these new occasions like baby moons and, you know, all of these events, because they buy experiences over, you know, the travel industry is through the roof, but new car sales aren't, because they're not materialistic in that way. It's about the experience. So have you found any pricing?
Let everyone try your product for free. Give it to them for free for a while. If you can swing it, do it. You know, when I took my first Uber, the first few rides were free.
Right.
I was hooked. When, you know, people try our product for 30 days or 60, whatever special we're running, you try it for free, you see the benefit. You let them experience it and become part of it. And then they decide at the end of 30 or 60 days if they want it or not. And if they don't, and they, you know, proceed without it, we don't lock them out. You can still use it locally, but now you offer them a discount. So it's, you know, millennials are value-driven. Mm-hmm. They like discounts. Everybody wants to feel like you're getting value. I'm that way.
Right.
Right. I don't like to overpay for anything, regardless of where I am financially in my life. I just psychologically, maybe it's a defect I have, but I have a great appreciation for people that are frugal and value-driven. So we try to present our product in the same way.
And then they get to experience it.
That's right.
Yeah, I think the freemium model, certainly for my family, like we're an Evernote family and we run on Evernote. We, for a long time, we didn't go up to a paid level, but now we're a paid Evernote family. But they had us for years before we were paying
them. We see the same thing. You know, we see people that convert 3 years after they've been using Keeper.
Right.
You just never know.
Mm-hmm.
So,
do we have any questions from the audience? Yes, sir.
I'm going to flip the title a little bit, and Darren, this is going to be directed to you because I have a real-world experience. I am a tech hack assistant for life-centric families. So whereas passwords and the proliferation of them is certainly something that in their analog real world, managing the paper, managing the data entry was just driving them nuts, you create a safety net that sort of projects them into this other tier of security. And as I was speaking to a client of mine who uses a product like that, which automatically enters the password and all this and that good stuff, we had a real distinct talk about the fact that systems do fail, software tangles itself up, you know, and that exploits happen, all kinds of things happen. And this gentleman was fully invested, kingdom and castle and all, into this type of a thing. So what I encouraged him to do was to contemplate, at the cost of a little convenience where the software is automatically entering this, maybe keeping a spreadsheet in Excel that is password protected that he can just put up in Dropbox so they have it ever available in a pivot point. If the whole internet goes down, he's got a local file sitting there that he can open up and get to. So I guess I'm wondering, in terms of the design of your product, do you offer sort of a little emigration of the data so that there is a drop of a localized index that is password protected as well?
Yeah, so that's a great question. You know, just people are scared of the cloud for, you know, many reasons, but the cloud is amazing. If you can figure out how to use the cloud to your advantage, then you're way ahead. And so the way that Keeper is architected is both native and cloud. So Keeper runs natively and locally on all of your devices. And we do that because we create what's called a hybrid cloud environment. We use the cloud architecture as a backup for your encrypted binary file, but all of your files are actually reside locally on your devices, as well as the master password and the encryption key. We do not control that. So if you're on a plane and you need to access all of your passwords, which I do because I don't know what my credit and debit card numbers are, they're in Keeper. I simply just log into the vault while I'm in the air. I'm not on the internet, and I just, it's native to my device. It's installed locally and available on the device. So that's how we protect, just by virtue of our architecture. So it's available in the cloud, it's available natively on all of your devices, so you have both online and offline access at all times.
And what would you see? Would you just see, you know, American Airlines and, or, you know, like just a list of all of your passwords?
Yeah, so, you know, I have mine set in folders. So I have folders for banking, commerce, social media, you know, business, personal, et cetera, however you want to organize it. And I just, you know, I hit the search icon and I just type, you know, MasterCard. And as I'm starting to type it, it dynamically finds those record matches. I tap on the record, and within that record, I'll see my MasterCard, my number, my expiration, my security code, as well as an image.
Do you want to share that with us?
Of the front and back side. Sure. Sure. You can go shopping at the Hermes store or something. But yeah, so it's so convenient. You know, the premise behind what we decided to do was to merge convenience and security. Not just keep you secure, but to make you more productive online. Because memorizing passwords and having to even type them into a site over and over again. I mean, we do it how many times a day? I don't type anything anymore. I don't type my username or my password. I click a fill button and I'm instantly into my Amazon account or my work email, and I have no idea what any of my passwords are anymore because Keeper creates a high strength random password for each one of my services and websites.
Okay, any other questions? Yes, over on the side there.
Thank you. The question is just very general for tech-centric families. The TV has long been the most connected device in our homes and brought the families together. But with the rise of mobile phones, do you think that the TV is still going to be like the prime where everyone like gets together, uses their Xbox, uses the TV, I mean all the connected devices? Is it like still going to be the temple where everyone just goes back and gathers together in the sofa, or do you see it going down some other path?
My kids are all teenagers and they never come to the TV, so they all have their tablets and they all have their streaming accounts, and TV doesn't, you know, only if they want to watch a live sports event, and even then they can get that, you know, through certain services today. I think that's something that has definitely changed. I'm not necessarily a millennial parent, but I have, you know, young kids that are completely away from the main TV. Even for gaming, you're seeing families even, sometimes buying a separate TV just to get their kids out of the main living room. Maybe I've done that. It's a different world today, and I think you're going to continue to see that as streaming services dominate in all kinds of entertainment.
You know, I think families need to be proactive about setting a culture. And I mean, David Kleeman was sharing this earlier today and this morning about the ways that, you know, emotional scheduling and that people may be coming back to, that there may be a resurgence of large screens for younger kids, and why that might draw people together. But families that want to have a Friday night movie night or play a game together can certainly make that part of their family culture, but that's an intention.
Yeah, and actually we do that, Friday night movie night. That's the only time we will get together.
But the default is that we're all in our own corners on our own devices. But
you know what's interesting? I spent almost a year across the country visiting homes and watching the behavior of families in their living room. And they will say, oh yeah, we get together and we watch TV together. But when we actually observe them, they're all on their individual devices. The TV might be running or a movie might be on. Yeah. But they're all individually on a device doing their own thing. So it's an interesting redefining of the behavior. They say, you know, it's just like the family dinner is no longer to the millennial mom. She considers a family dinner even if only one other person is sitting down with her. So we're using terminology of, let's say, 5 or 10 years ago, but the behavior is very different. So I think that's what you're talking about. Is there any other question in the audience?
No double screening is a rule. A lot of kids report to me when I ask them what are the rules about technology in your home, they'll say, oh, no double screening. But that comes from somewhere.
Yeah.
Right, that comes from the fact that everyone in their home is double screening.
When you're eating potato chips.
You know, after the home, the car is where the family is the most. Have you seen a change of behaviors? I know that 70% of children will do their homework in a car, which is creates an opportunity for someone. I don't know what the opportunity is, but there's an opportunity there because there's a behavior. Have you seen a change, Bryson, in the behaviors of what's happening in those cars?
Yeah, well as I mentioned at the beginning, I mean, a lot of the expectations are on how people communicate. Mm-hmm. And as you have teenagers that only communicate with each other through various messaging apps, and then they get to the point where they start driving, then that's a very, that's
unnerving.
That's very unnerving for the parents. So that behavior is needs to be better controlled. So that's something that we're really focused on as well.
I mean, I've noticed with my teenagers that the aux cord is a very important, like if the car doesn't have an aux cord in it, Mom, I can't go anywhere in your car. It doesn't have an aux cord for my phone. I'm like.
Or Bluetooth.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it's interesting. I think that there are a lot of things that are happening in the car. Like I just, saw a company called Navdi, and they have this solution. It's an aftermarket solution that really helps with, texting. And I think more and more of those kinds of things, whether it's in the automobile or whether it's in the home, will continue to help the families with safety and also protection of, digital content.
Kids are growing up watching their parents text and drive. I can tell you that because I'm in schools all over the country, and everywhere I go, kids are reporting this to me. So they're learning it from somewhere. They don't start it when they're 16.
We might be guilty of that up here. I'm not sure, but we might be.
So we have just 2 minutes. Is there any other question out there before I ask a final question? So you guys see the clock. We have 3 minutes left. Is there any parting thoughts that you might like to share with the audience on any of your experience with communicating your hacks to parents or the opportunities?
I think it's just important to know what your kids are doing and who they're communicating with. I mean, I've seen just amazing things just with my own family. Something's great, something's not so great. When I see something, whether it's cyberbullying or an app that's turning my kid into a zombie, you have to intercede immediately and make sure that you keep them on the right track. And it requires a lot more attention. It's a different type of attention. And we try to get our kids to go out and do sports, outside activities a lot, because they're so drawn to those devices. I mean, they're addictive. They're absolutely addictive. So you've got to pay really close attention to what they're doing.
And there's all kinds of new things that are coming to those devices. Like, for example, augmented reality. Yep. Right? We had a little taste of it with Pokemon Go, but then you look at some of the Google technology and, basically having these tablets where you basically hold them around and you see, you know, dinosaurs and other things sitting in the audience. Mm-hmm. And the technology is amazing, and it's difficult for the millennial families to kind of, and the older families also, keep up with that.
Right.
So yeah, watching them is really key. If they go into their room, you should go into their room every once in a while.
Yeah. I mean, I look at how they interact with Snapchat and the augmentation that they use and how they're selling advertising and how companies are selling their brand through augmented reality templates. Mm-hmm. It's a whole new era. It's amazing.
We need to cultivate some healthy skepticism and questioning in our kids and not teach them to just, you know, accept fake news, accept brands
except
as friends.
That Snapchat really doesn't save anything, right?
Right. There's some really good opportunities for us to do that as adults, as educators, as parents, and I think we need to do it. And we also need to empower parents to say, parents do have relevant experience. They have lived experience. They've been through not being invited to something. They've been through being left out. They've been through gossip. And so even if they didn't experience that in Snapchat, they still have relevant wisdom for their kids.
Yeah.
Well, I want to thank everyone for being here. We're out of time, but thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.